we saw that occlusion can be of three types, type 1, class 1, class 2 and class 3. I'm not saying that any one particular type is better than the other, but usually the class 1 type of occlusion is the most favorable occlusion type, even if you consider it for function, aesthetic or appearance. Now, as we saw, the occlusion in permanent dentition is dependent upon the eruption schedule or pattern of the primary, same as we saw it in, as we see it in case of the primary dentition. Now, the eruption pattern in case of the permanent dentition is slightly variable. The first to erupt are the molars, followed by the central lateral incisors. In case of the mandible, it is straightforward. Central, lateral, canine, first premolar, second molar, third molar. But in case of the maxilla, it is slightly altered. The canine usually erupts after the first premolar, almost in 70% of the cases. In a few cases, it erupts even after the second premolar. So that sequence is slightly different in case of the maxilla and mandible. But remember that this, if the teeth are not sticking to the schedule of eruption, then by the time they erupt, the teeth which are adjacent to them, they will encroach in their space. If they encroach their space, there won't be any space for them to erupt out completely. Okay? Then that would result into the what we call as malocclusion. Now, usually in girls, the dentition erupt almost 5 months earlier than as compared to the boys. Okay? Now, as we saw that eruption pattern is dependent upon various factors. In case of the gestural dentition, we saw that it is more dependent on hereditary factors. But in case of the permanent teeth, the eruption pattern is more dependent upon the environmental factors. Few important factors which determine this eruption pattern is the eruption time and shedding of the deciduous counterparts. Then the spaces available for the eruption of the permanent teeth. Now, so there are few important factors which are considered as an ideal requirement for development of normal type 1 occlusion. Yes, the favorable eruption sequence of canine, as we saw. In case of the maxilla it erupts late, the reason is the maxillary canines develop very far away from its functional position. Okay, and plus, now this is one school of thought. The other school of thought is that why it is erupting late, because maxillary canines are the teeth which will be guiding your jaw in the lower jaw in the various occlusal movements. Okay, then how the incisal liability is relieved, how the spaces like leeway space or primate spaces were utilized for the eruption of the permanent. So this is just a schematic presentation of the favorable eruption. In mandible, as we saw, it is quite straightforward. First molar, then the central lateral canine, first premolar, second, and then the molars, second molar and third molar. Only in case of the maxilla, the change is the canine usually erupts after the first premolar. In some cases, it might erupt even after the second premolar. Now, dental arch form. Now, the dental arch form is very important. As I told you, our arch, maxillary or mandible, it should be U-shaped, paraboloid in the form ellipsoid. It should not be a V-shaped arch. Now, why this U-shape is so important? If you see any ancient architectures, you will be seeing many, very large dome-shaped structures. Those domes are so huge that they are not supported by any pillars at their center parts, but usually they are supported by the arches. So the arch shape, why it is important is, now for example, this is the arch, if you apply any force on any part of this arch, all that force is going to dissipate at the bottom of the arch. So it will not make the arch to fall out. Even if the force is applied here, it will not make that dome shape to fall down or that arch to collapse. Rather than the forces will be transmitted directly to the base of it. So same thing is applicable in our jaws also. Why they have to be U-shaped? Because U-shaped, all the forces will be transmitted directly to the stronger posterior parts of our jaw bones. Secondly, U-shaped would have as we saw in the primary dentition, maxillary arch would always be larger as compared to that of the mandibular arch. There are maybe certain factors which can change the shape of the arch. I will just enumerate that. The first one are the any developmental defects which are occurring in the basal bones of the either of the jaws, malpositioning of the teeth. Now, certain children having habits like thumb sucking, nail biting, all of them in such habits, the maxillary jaw will grow more faster as compared to the mandible, resulting into change in the relationship with the lower jaw. Then there are normally the changes in any arch won't cause any profound effect on the occlusion. Most of the time, any small discrepancies in the arch size is not going to make the occlusion that abnormal. But the discrepancies in case of the arch form of the two jaws, larger, more discrepancies are definitely going to result in poor occlusal relationship. For example, if the maxilla is very large as compared to the mandible, it will develop into the skeletal type malocclusion. Whereas if the mandible is quite larger, then it will develop into the skeletal type 3 malocclusion. Okay. Now, another relationship which is important to understand is the overlap of the teeth. Now, as we saw in the deciduous dentition, similarly in the permanent dentition also, the maxillary arch overhangs the mandibular arch. Okay. Now, this relationship, we call it as overjet and overbite. Overjet is horizontal overlap. That is, if you draw a line along the radial aspect from the upper central, then the distance from the lower central to that line is called as overjet. Vertical overlap is called as overbite. That is, vertical overbite means how much the upper maxillary teeth are covering the mandibular teeth. That is called as overbite. Now, this overjet and overbite, they are very significant. They have a very important significance. That is, now we start with the overbite first. Overbite is important because it increases the duration of occlusal contact during the progressive lateral movement. Means what? Whenever you are biting anything, now for example, you are taking out a small part of a bread slice. When in this particular motion, which function is important? The function of incisors is important. Who is going to take down that small bite is the incisor, scissor-like action created by the incisors. So how this is possible only because of the overbite. Overjet is more important for protecting the adjacent soft tissue. For example, whenever we are eating, our cheeks, they are very taut and they are completely pressed on the teeth. Why? So that the food doesn't accumulate in the vestibule. But while doing so, very rarely your cheek will come under your teeth. The reason is the overjet, the maxillary overhang on the mandibular teeth, not allowing the chew to come in between the teeth when during the mastication. Same thing is for the tongue also, but on the tongue side, the protection is less as compared to that of the cheek side. Okay. Then, when this overjet and overbite, they also play one very important role is whenever the incisors come in contact with each other, especially during the protrusive movement, at that time, all the posterior teeth, they get excluded. This is very important. That is only when you would be able to take off a bite of something. Whenever you are biting, for example, you are biting an apple, just try it. If your posterior teeth are in contact with each other, you won't be able to bite. So to have that scissor-like action, they have to be excluded. Okay. Now, if there is excessive overbite, then also it is harmful. It will result into the lip biting or the lower teeth will be hurting the lingual gingiva of the upper teeth. If there is no overjet at all, especially in case of the posterior teeth, usually that will result into the cheek bite. Okay. Now, next point in this is the curvatures of the occlusal plane. Now, our occlusal surfaces, they are not flat. All of them, especially the mandibular teeth, they are arranged along the curved planes. there are two curves, curvatures, which we refer them as curve of Spi and curve of Hansu. Now, curve of Spi is also called as a compensating curve. It begins, now you can see that it begins from the cusp of the canine, and then it follows the buccal cusp of all the posterior teeth until it moves towards the PM joint. Okay. Now, you can see that it is forming a curve surface like this. This particular curve of Spi is very important because it discludes the posterior teeth whenever your jaw is in a protrusive movement, what we call it as incisor guidance. Next curve is the curve of Mansu. Now, curve of Mansu is similar to that of the curve of Spi, only in the different plane. Curve of Mansu, usually you will see it in the coronal plane. Okay. Now, this is the curve which is moving from the buccal cusp of the premolar to the buccal cusp of the other side, that is from the right side premolar, left side premolar. So it will form such this curve like structure. Okay. Now, this curve like the importance of the monsoon's curve, why it is so here. Now, if you see the teeth properly here, what you notice that the maxillary teeth are angularly, whereas the mandibular teeth, they are angulated lingual. Okay. So this curve, why it is important? Because it aids in distributing and directing the occlusal forces along the long axis of this particular teeth. Okay. So it is very important to maintain this both this curve in any of the restorations of prosthesis you are making. Now, next is the angulations of the individual teeth. As I told you, almost all teeth in our jaw, if you look for example, just the mandibular incisor, they are also inclined but not as much as other teeth. All teeth do show some angulations. Now, these angulations could be either in the basolingual plane or in the mesiodystal plane. It is depending, but all teeth show some degree of angulations. Now, why they are angulated? The only why these teeth are angulated is so that to allow the occlusal forces to get transmitted through their long axis. When the occlusal forces will be transmitted through their long axis, then only they would be able to wear them properly without either getting fractured or destroying their supporting apparatus. Okay. So, now for this, all our teeth, now you can see that these are all these colored lines, they are showing the angulations of different teeth at different planes. In short, I will tell you now, see here. This is the angulation of the maxillary teeth. Now, this angulation is in case of the mesiodystal plane, this buccolingual plane. This angulation is in case of the mesiodystal plane. This is for central incisor, lateral incisors, canine, in that way. Okay. Same thing is for the mandibular. Now here you can see that mandible in mesiodystal dimension they are almost straight, but if you will see that in the buccolingual dimension they are having a slight lingual inclination, buccal inclination. Now here this is just a degrees of inclination each individual teeth has to. Now as I told you, we have to follow. Or we have to be almost close to this value so that the teeth will be functioning properly in their